Hello, brothers and sisters. This is Dr. William Snedlin coming to you from With One Accord Ministries with it's a little bit different. It's sort of semi in the realm of prophecy and end time stuff, but also a warning and an exhortation. So with that in mind, I want to start out with something that's rather personal and that relates to something that happened in our family many years ago, but that also happened to the whole world. In 1997, it happened in September that my father passed away. And ironically, for whatever reason, that very same week, Princess Diana was killed in an auto accident. I'm sure those of you that were around then remember that. It was a huge story. And that also, I think the same day or within a day or two of that, the famous Catholic, I guess now she's maybe even a saint, Mother Teresa died. And, you know, in the midst of grieving for my father and praying and whatnot, I just noticed the huge amount of coverage for the death of Diana. And I understand she was an enormous media celebrity, and I'm not saying any of this to disrespect her or her memory. I, you know, don't know an awful lot about her, but she seemed to be a reasonably good person. But, you know, I mean, it was just, to me, it was very indicative of the state our world is in, even way back then in 97, which is, you know, 20-some years ago, that the world put all of that energy, all of that media coverage, everything into her death, which I'm going to talk about more in a couple minutes, and very little coverage of this woman. And I'm not, of course, very much of a fan of the Catholic Church at all, as I think you know, but she seems to have done a lot of good in India. Not that she was the only one. I know there were other people over there trying to do great work for orphans and so on too. But, you know, she was indicative to most people of the Christian virtues, and yet she was not much, you know, talked about. So, and I think that's indicative of the way the whole world has gone. And it's even more so today. And I'm doing this video because, you know, we just had the passing of Queen Elizabeth. Of course, the succession or accession, whatever word is, of her son Charles to the throne. And I think it's appropriate to drill down into this. I mentioned things about the royal family in passing, but we need to look into this because this could be a very, both religiously, spiritually momentous thing, but it could also be a very important political and economic thing. And we'll get into that more later. But I want to start out by reading a passage from Scripture, from Revelation chapter 12, first verse and following. There appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth and pained to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head. Now let me skip over to Revelation 13. Again, the first verse. And it says, and I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his head the name of blasphemy. And the name and the beast which I saw was like a leopard, and his feet were the feet of a bear, and his mouth was the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and his great authority. So I'm going to kind of see how that might apply to what I'm about to talk about in a few minutes. But just to begin with, It's important to understand in terms of the history of America, and I realize probably a lot of you folks don't happen to be Americans, that from the very beginning of the American, if you will, rebellion against British rule, there was this idea that the king was a tyrant and was not godly, because of course for hundreds of years the British monarchy reigned with the idea that we have this divine right of kings. And I'll talk more about that in a couple minutes. But, you know, and so, for example, the Committee for Intercolonial Correspondence in 1775 put forth this statement in a letter. They said, "We have no king but Jesus," quote unquote. No king but Jesus. That's my sentiment as well. And also, at that same time, another person who I can't drill down and find the name of, but they made the remark, either Elohim will be your king, or else your king will be your God. And unfortunately, those sentiments, which were at the very core, at the very root of America's beginnings, have kind of fallen by the wayside. You know, since then, many Americans have just become totally enamored with, you know, the royal family, royalty, you know, all this stuff. I mean, especially since the beginning of Queen Elizabeth's reign, which was, of course, in the early 50s, the last century. And I think it's not a healthy thing, partly for political reasons, but even for spiritual reasons. And, you know, the question that I would ask you, you know, as we look at it, because I know, like I'm sure many of you, you know, I have an iPhone. And, you know, you open the thing up and it seems like almost every day there's something about, you know, something in the royal family. Even before this thing happened with the passing of the queen. You know, it's like every other day, you know. And I mean, I don't care, frankly. But, you know, obviously the media wants us to care. And, of course, it's a way of getting, you know, eyeballs and all of that. But still, I find it spiritually troubling. And here, let me say this. Many, many years ago, again, about the time of Diana's passing, I wrote a newsletter article in The Liberator, which I think we have on our website, although maybe not. We had to take down all of our Liberator articles because people were getting after us for copyright infringement, even though it was not legit. But you know how that goes. We get harassed a lot for one thing or another because we're trying to spread the truth. But I'm going to try and get this article up again one way or the other. In this article, we talked about the right of the divine king, which I also talk about in my book, Wicca, and which was published a long time ago. That was published like in 89 or 90, I think. And anyway, in that thing is this concept, which is uniquely, it may have gone further back than that, but it is uniquely in the last 1,000 years or so of English history, the idea that in order for certain things to prosper, for the land and the people and the power of the king to prosper, every now and then that the king must be slain, because there is something special in the king's blood, and his blood must be spilled out upon the earth to bring about some kind of magical or agricultural or economic benefit. Okay. And at that time, I was speculating, because I can't prove this, but that Diana's death was, because she had actually more quote-unquote royal blood than Charles did. And of course, at that time, they were, I think, divorced or separated or something. But anyway, and by her death, by violence, shedding of blood, because I'm sure there was, that created a magical effect. And, you know, you can look into this if you want, but like the place where she was killed, which was a tunnel, I think it was in or near Paris, was called the Place of the Virgin. It was a place where centuries earlier, virgins were sacrificed. Of course, obviously, Diana wasn't a virgin. But there was all sorts of occult significance to the date that she was killed, to the place that she was killed. I mean, she wasn't killed there, but she, you know, they, I think they took her to a hospital, but the time they got there, she was dead. And I really do believe she was murdered by elements within either the royal family or the British, you know, intelligence services or something. Again, I can't prove that. But it's critical to understand this, because by doing that, they were attempting, to pardon the expression, pump fresh occult blood, fresh occult power into the royal family, which was kind of withering on the vine at that time. Okay? So that's something to consider. And again, if you want to know more about this divine right thing, the divine king, we'll try and get that thing up, or maybe I'll do a YouTube video on it. But the point is, it is a very ancient belief that the king is also a high priest of his country, that the high priest is the king and vice versa. And, you know, and of course, this is like a copy, a satanic copy of the fact that Yeshua is our high priest and is our king. And of course, the devil is a copycat. And so he's trying to copy all of this. So I just wanted to get this out there for your consideration, because as I look at down through the centuries, these royal people are capable of just about any skullduggery. And I'm going to explain a little bit about that in a minute. But I just would exhort you, if you're one of these people, maybe everybody listening to this isn't, but if you're one of these people that's fascinated by the royal family, you buy all the magazines at the checkout stand that have pictures of Harry and Meghan on it, or, you know, all of this stuff. I mean, stop it. I don't think it's spiritually helpful. I think it's a waste of your money and your time. You know, read your Bible, for heaven's sakes. Or read stories about great men and women of God, the saints of history or something. Don't read about these guilt-edged thugs, because frankly, that's what they are. A case can be made, and I'm going to talk more about this in a couple minutes, that basically the royal family, well, they call themselves the firm, and basically that they're a criminal enterprise of unparalleled proportions. I mean, they make the mafia look like pikers. So this is nothing to be following, nothing to be encouraging, nothing to emulate. And mind you, I appreciate the English people. If you happen to be a British subject and you're listening to this, I'm not. I love the British people. I love the British culture. But I think it's been a mistake that you folks have allowed these guilt-edged thugs to be, well, of course, lately they've had very little power, but still, you know, they're like a spiritual authority over your country. And that's dangerous, because as I think most of us understand, Britain is really sinking into the depths of whatever. I mean, you know, between, you know, all of the woke stuff over there and all of the immigration issues and weird politicians and the COVID thing and all of that. I mean, Britain is really a mess. And most Brits know that. And again, I'm getting a little off topic here, but we might have to make this into two videos. But anyway, let me get into it. So we pay attention to these people, I think, because they're royal. But why are they royal? Well, honestly, if you look at the history, these people have basically whacked and slaughtered and raped and stabbed their way through history, one criminal family fighting another criminal family back and forth for power. And, you know, the history of the British monarchy has basically been that. And of course, on the positive side, there's always been this idea, well, we need a king to kind of unite behind. You know, we need some kind of figurehead person. And I think in some ways, superficially, Queen Elizabeth served as a very positive, you know, figure. superficially. So the other problem is that for literally centuries, there has been a dark current of occult sewage flowing through the British monarchy. Evil, foul stuff. And I'm going to explain that right now, but I want to do a tiny bit of history, and I don't want anybody hears the word history, it's like, but I'll be brief. The funny thing is that the monarchy basically got its start with William the First, who won the Battle of Hastings in 1066. And he wasn't even English, he was a Saxon. But, you know, that was okay, that was in 1066. We jump forward a couple centuries. I'm trying to be brief with this. This is an important point, though, because there was a king, Edward III, and he, in 1348, is when most scholars say this happened, he founded the Order of the Garter. Now, this is a critical moment in the history of the monarchy, because what happened, and this is the legend, and of course, you know, maybe it's true, maybe it's not, but is that he was at a dance, a ball, something like that, dancing with the Countess of Salisbury. And as they were dancing, her garter fell off. Okay. Now, mind you, this was like, you know, almost 1,000 years ago, and people weren't prudish. This wasn't Victorian England. This was way back then. But for whatever reason, everybody was shocked that this woman lost her garter. So, he picks up the garter very chivalrously, puts it back on her thigh, and says, "Honi soi qui mal y pense," which means, "Shame be unto him who thinks evil of this." Loose translation. That became the motto of the Order of the Garter. To this day, you'll see those words on all the heraldic junk of the Order of the Garter. Now, what some historians believe is that this Countess of Salisbury was the witch queen of England, because high-ranking female witches wear a garter as a symbol of their authority. And I know this to be true, because when I was a witch, my wife had a garter. As a high priestess, she had a garter that she wore. And down through the centuries, this he started this Order of the Garter, and it's been a very elite order down through the centuries to this very day. And it's one of the highest honors bestowed by the monarchy, because I'm sure, as most of you know, the queen can make somebody a knight, or they can different bizarre titles or whatever. And this is one of the highest, is to become a knight order, a member of the Order of the Garter. And this, I believe, and many scholars agree, this became the beginning of an alliance between the crown and the Celtic witchcraft community in Britain. Because at that time, Britain was somewhat Christian, but also there was a lot of pagans and druids, as you probably know, running around. And because of this, there was this unholy alliance going on. So, and this continues right up to this very day. If you go down through the centuries, you see you've got the House of Plantagenet, you got the House of Tudor, you've got the House of Stuart, which was a momentary bright light, where we have King James of Scotland becoming King James of England. And I don't need to go into all the details, but he was actually a Scottish king. And then they, because Elizabeth died, the first Elizabeth, died without an heir, then, you know, he became the king of, he was the next best thing they had, so he became the king of England. And he ended up, of course, financing and sponsoring the production of what we call a King James Bible today, which is one of the towering achievements of British history, was the production of the King James Bible. So after the Stuarts came the Hanovers, and which were all Germans, and this idea that these people were English, no, like Queen Elizabeth at best is half English. So anyway, we had the House of Hanover, and eventually we got Queen Victoria, who of course most of you know reigned for a very long time, had a very, you know, linked, and under her reign, basically Britain became a superpower. And I think it was partly because she sent out, in the early part of her reign, she made sure that people, when she was colonizing all these places, she also sent out missionaries with the Bible. And she did a great deal, you know, in the first half of her reign to spread the word of Elohim through Africa, through India, through, you know, because, you know, they used to say the sun never set on the British Empire. And this was at the height of its reign, was the last half of Victoria's reign, and then all the way up to World War One. So, but here's the thing. Albert, her prince consort, who she deeply, deeply loved, he died, I think, of typhoid in 1861. And by that time, they, of course, had, I think it was nine children. And a few of them were really quite perverse, but who knows. And after that, something dark got into Victoria and her court, which I don't fully understand, but I will just say that because it's evident from what was going on. You know, there was the Opium Wars, where basically Britain took over the opium trade and used opium to try and reduce the power of China, because there was economic and political warfare going on in the Pacific between Britain and China, because back then China was a monarchy too. They had an emperor. And, you know, so there was a lot of nasty stuff going on by the time of her demise. And her son was a total profligate. I mean, he was out there whoring around and mind you, since the time of Henry VIII, the sovereign of England has also been the head of the Church of England. Because Henry VIII, as you probably know, broke away from Rome, which was fine with me, but, you know, he started his own fiefdom, his own church, because he wanted to marry Anne Boleyn and divorce Catherine of Aragon. Most know that story. But, you know, so here's this guy who's the head of a large, the Anglican Church in America, the Episcopal Church, pardon me, in England, the Episcopal Church in America. Supposedly the sovereign is the head of it, and yet this Edward, a total creep, a total pervert, you know. Now, we go through, you know, Edward and George V and a couple other people, and then finally we come to Queen Elizabeth. And of course, I don't want to get into it, but her, the reason partly that she came to the throne is that her father was forced to be king because the guy who was supposed to be king, I think Edward VII, fell in love with an American divorcing and had to abdicate. So he ran off with, I'm sorry, I forget her name, but anyhow, that kind of threw a monkey wrench into the monarchy, and it ended up that Elizabeth became queen. And then, of course, strange things started happening. Charles, of course, is her firstborn, and she had several other children. And a lot of them got into trouble. I mean, you know, we all know about the thing with Charles and Diana. Lots of stuff around that. The fact that he was having an affair with this Camilla lady, and apparently did not really treat Diana well at all, although who knows. And of course the fact that there's things that you know, just were not right about the whole thing. And I want to share at this point with you, you may have heard me say this, because I've said this on a couple of radio shows over the years, but I don't think I've ever talked about it on YouTube. But when I was a Druid, and I was made a high priest of the Druidic order by, excuse me, the Grand Master Druid of North America at that time. This was 1973, mind you. So this was long before Charles married Diana. And at that time, in the course of the things he was teaching us, this high-level Druid guy, he said that there was a prophecy that had been around for many centuries, that when the Prince of Wales would marry a woman who had the name of the goddess, that their son, their firstborn son, would be a kind of messianic figure of incredible power. He would be a reincarnation of Arthur, King Arthur, who, you know, very famous, maybe mythological, maybe real king of early England. And later on, as I was studying this through as a believer, I really was talking about an antichrist figure, basically an antichrist figure. Now, here's the interesting thing. As far as I looked into this, and no Prince of Wales married a woman. They were all like, had, you know, biblical names, Mary or Elizabeth or whatever. And so here comes Diana Spencer. And of course, Diana is the consummate name of the goddess. I mean, it's a Roman name for Artemis, but it's a goddess. And so when he married her, Charles, she fulfilled that prophecy. And again, that happened a decade after I was told this. And then, of course, they had William, who's now the Prince of Wales. So we're going to put a pin in that and come back to it in a minute.